Hello. Today I am going to show you how to install and run one of the best tools there is to circumvent internet censorship. Shadowsocks. It was created in 2012 for the purpose of tunneling under the Great Firewall of China. To this day, it remains the best way of successfully going through this digital barrier and others, by making your internet traffic look practically identical to a regular HTTPS connection. Better than any other obfuscation method, including VPNs. I will leave some links in the description section below, where you can learn about how Shadowsocks works. Basically, it's just a proxy. It reroutes an internet connection through a third server, making it appear like you're in a different location. But Shadowsocks isn't a category of its own. It is a proxy, yes. But it also has properties of a VPN. For example, encryption. And it also depends on you controlling the server that redirects your traffic. The good news though, is that it is extremely easy to configure. You will be shocked to see how quickly I set the whole thing up. Before we start, let me show you speed test results comparing a WireGuard VPN. WireGuard with TLS tunneling that obfuscates VPN traffic. And Shadowsocks. If you want to try out any of these other tools, there are videos on my channel that will show you how to do it. All linked in the description. Let's run Shadowsocks. You might want to run Shadowsocks because of privacy concerns, or censorship concerns. When it's time for you to buy a server, please put some thought into which jurisdiction is best for your use case. So let's start. I already have a server running, hosted on a VPS in Iceland. You can see me buy it anonymously, in a video linked below. I will SSH into it. By the way, this is the same server that you will have seen me use in my WireGuard video, and my WireGuard over WebSockets video. My WireGuard VPN is running. As well as my WebSockets tunnel. These are my firewall rules. So I will install Shadowsocks. The services will not interfere with each other. A service for Shadowsocks is created, started and enabled by default. Here's your Shadowsocks configuration file. Copy the IP of your server and paste it into your file. By the way, the client will need this random password to connect to the server. You can change it if you like. Restart the service. And you're pretty much done. My Shadowsocks server is running and listening on port 8388. Add a firewall rule. And let's move on to the client. Install the Shadowsocks package. Here in the client, we need to run a different binary. Shadowsocks local. So first, edit the service file. For the changes to take effect, don't forget to reload all unit files. Before restarting the service, let's look at the configuration file. My server's IP address. I need to add local address and point it to my local host. The password is still in my clipboard. My client is ready. Let's test Shadowsocks. The source of my traffic is an IP in Denmark. Let's redirect it by adding my Shadowsocks proxy. Go to Settings. Scroll down. Network Settings. Manual Proxy Configuration. Socks Proxy. Point it to your local host, on the local port written in the Shadowsocks configuration file. Select Socks version 5. And this is very important. Select Proxy DNS when using Socks. Let's check what my IP is now. The source of my traffic now is my Shadowsocks server located in Iceland. Make sure to perform an extended DNS leak test. Everything is okay. So this is how easy it is to use your proxy. If you want to bypass it, just go to Settings. And you're back to your home IP. Now, let me show you how to add your Shadowsocks proxy as the first hop in your Tor circuit when you use the Tor browser. It is a very interesting feature that can really help circumvent surveillance within the Tor network itself. This is the current Tor circuit. I cannot do anything about the exit node, but I can proxy into the entry node. Go to Settings. Connection. Scroll down. Advanced Settings. Add your Shadowsocks proxy. Since we are adding a proxy at the beginning of the route, there's no obvious way of making sure that this is working. My proxy points to localhost, so the new hop does not show in the UI. The Tor browser logs, by the way, do not seem to provide any confirmation. I'm not happy just trusting, I need to verify. There's a few ways I could do this, but the most fun is to install a network monitoring application in the server, and create some traffic in the client, so I can really see if it is being redirected. Install, Inload. Make sure that Inload is monitoring the traffic from your external interface. You can switch between different interfaces by pressing Tab. Let's go back to the client and generate some traffic. How about downloading a big file? Nothing is happening. There's something wrong with the proxy settings. But everything looks good. Let's try restarting the Tor browser. Let's try it again. Starting the download. There's some traffic. And there it is. Okay. So that was it. I had to restart the Tor browser. It is a serious UX failure, not to warn the user every time the proxy settings are changed. Keep that in mind. Adding the Shadowsocks proxy to your web browser is not going to reroute the traffic that you might generate from the command line. For example, commands like wget, curl, gpg, get. They all connect to the internet to fetch data. To fix this, install Proxychains. Edit its configuration file. I encourage you to learn about the different options. The defaults are probably okay. Just make sure that you have proxy DNS uncommented. So, scroll down, comment the default Tor proxy, and add your own Shadowsocks proxy. If I use the command curl on the URL ifconfig.io, it will return the IP address from where I am sending the request. If I precede any command by Proxychains, all web traffic will be routed through my proxy. The option Quiet returns only the IP. And if you happen to have the Tor daemon installed on your system, you can use yet another route to access your destination. Actually, there's another IP I can use if I disconnect the VPN that I've been using all along in my client computer. You didn't think I was going to show you my home IP, did you? I will conclude this tutorial by showing you how to protect your Shadowsocks server from denial of service attacks. Here in the server I am already running fail to ban. Please watch the video linked below, where I explain what it does and how to properly set it up. Basically, it will protect specific services from brute force attacks and denial of service attacks. Currently, I only have one active jail for SSH. In this last section, I will show you how to add a jail for Shadowsocks. Let me go back to the client and change the authentication password. My password is now incorrect. I will follow the logs in the server in real time while I try to use Shadowsocks. Let's see what happens. Whenever a service prints authentication errors into its logs and shows the IP address that failed the challenge, fail to ban can be used to create a jail for it. Luckily, the Shadowsocks GitHub repository already includes a working fail to ban filter and jail that we can use. This big command will create a filter that will search the logs for IP addresses that failed to authenticate. Just copy paste it. And this is the jail for Shadowsocks. Add it to your jail.local file. If you're not happy with the default settings, change them at will. Please note that the maximum authentication failures for any given IP address is 3. Everything seems to be working correctly. I have a new jail. The filter has already picked from the logs my previous failed attempt to authenticate. I'll keep trying. While you keep an eye on those logs. Trying to access the server. Failure to authenticate. Trying again. Failure to authenticate for the third time. And my IP address is banned. I see no downsides to using Shadowsocks over a VPN for simple web browsing. That is, except for its theoretically weaker encryption algorithms. As you've just seen, it is extremely easy to deploy. And its increased bandwidth is really noticeable. So it's up to you. Once you rent a VPS for traffic routing purposes, you can maximize its versatility by running a variety of services simultaneously, as you have seen me do. Until next time.